us. God is love. He that dwelleth in love that God has to us, God dwelleth in you. If God's not doing something for you, God's not dwelling in you. God's always got to be doing something for us that is motivating what we are doing for Him. Now watch. Herein is our love made perfect. They got that up in here. Now, when you read this, it really sounds like that we ought to have something for God. Don't it? Man, I need to have perfect love. But did you know this is all wrong? If I know you've been studying, Pastor, but in my margin, if you got a Bible with a margin, in the Greek, it says, herein is God's love with us made perfect. That's big. That's big. That one Greek word is big. Because it reverses us to God's love with us has to be made perfect. God coming through for us all the time has to be made perfect. That we may have boldness in the day of judgment. As He is, so are we in this world. This boldness comes from Him. Comes from Him giving us. It don't come from us trying to do something for Him. It comes, everything that we ever going to do for God has to come through Jesus. And so, then verse 18, He goes right into fear. There is no fear in love. Now, what you could see or think, and I've heard it talk like this. There's no fear when we love God. But that ain't the text of what the Lord is saying. There's no fear in God loving us. There ain't never nothing wrong when God loves you. When God come through for you, and God deliver you, and God prosper you, and God bless you, there ain't never no fear in. Amen. Because His love with us casts out fear.
Yes.
Because fear hath torment. He that feareth, when you fear, you're not made perfect in His love for you. You're not trusting that He loves you. And then He goes to 19. We love Him. He go. Because He first loved us.
Yes. Amen.
You can't come up with no love if He ain't loved you.
All right.
Here's something that I was in a service with Creflo Dollar. 10 years ago, he came to Nashville and I went to the service, this one service. And he was teaching. And Jesus spoke to me during that service. It's in a voice. And here's what Jesus told me. He said, nowhere in the letters or the epistles is any of the apostles ever said how much they love God? And then Jesus told me that it's not in one verse to love God with your heart, soul, mind, and strength in none of the letters or the epistles. He said it ain't in one verse. I was like, look, it wasn't. It wasn't. Not in one verse to love God with your heart, soul, and mind, and strength. If it was the doctrine of Christ, it would have to be in the epistles. It's not in one verse. From Acts all the way to Jude, it ain't in one verse to love God with your heart, soul, and strength. And the apostles had the revelation. John, they never identified that they loved God so much. They identified, I'm the disciple the Lord loves. to change, I think.
That's good.
That I'm the one the Lord loves. And I believe we need to keep ourselves in a position where God can keep loving us every day,
yes,
blessing us every day, coming through for us every day.
Yes. Glory to God.
That's what John said. He always said, I'm the disciple the Lord loves. You will be surprised. It took me 2 or 3 years to get that out of me, telling everybody how much I love the Lord. It took me years to get that out of me. Because see, we really boasting about us and don't know it. We not boasting about him. And so the Lord taught me to get people to start thinking and start speaking every day, I'm the disciple the Lord loves. Let me tell you what happens when that gets in you. It makes your faith work excellent and perfect every day. In him. I'm the one he loves. It takes the pressure off of you of trying to love him and puts the pressure on your faith to receive his love every day. I'm the one the Lord. Say that to your neighbor. Say, I'm the disciple the Lord loves.
I'm the disciple the Lord loves.
Saints, we as Christians should never be looking to get loved. We're supposed to know and believe the love that God has to us. Now go back to John 14:27. This is everybody's problem. It's a love of Jesus loving you problem. But in the heaven he loves you in, you ain't got no problem no more. If you have nothing to complain about, nothing to gripe about, nothing to be frustrated about, nothing to be irritated about. When Jesus loves you, you can't have no lack. No lack. And Jesus loves you. When Jesus loved people, they had too much fish, too much bread left. He don't ever love something that it ain't enough. God so loved the world, he gave Jesus. Every day we should be in a place where God is giving us Jesus in whatever situation that we need him in our life. He should be given to us every day. Every day. We should see Jesus as a gift. Now look at now you read this. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give. Look, I want you to see this. You can never earn his peace. So I'm going to break it down what his peace is a little bit more. You can't earn it. Let me tell you something else you can do. You can't do with Jesus. You can't mess this up. You can't mess up who Jesus is and what Jesus did. You can't mess it up. I don't care how bad you did. I don't care how full of doubt you get. I don't care how worried, how stressful, how sick you get. I don't care what you go through. You ain't messing up Jesus Christ. You can't mess up his blood. You can't mess up our redemption. You can't mess up our hope. You can't mess God up. You can't mess up we more than conquerors. You can't mess up I can do all things through Christ. What you can do is not walk in it. Let me tell you where a lot of people live, and probably many of you, is what am I doing wrong? Why this ain't working right? And you're always looking for faults in yourself instead of his love. I don't never look for no faults. I always let Jesus just keep loving me. He's smart enough to show me if I need something straightened up. I just need to let him love me every day. So, peace, and I want y'all to get this. Peace I leave with you, but I want you to get these next 2 words. Say it out loud. Wait a minute. Peace I leave with you, now I want the next 2 words.
Peace.
Say that again. It ain't yours. You ain't never supposed to ever think you can mess this up. It's supposed to mess you up. It's untroubled. It's undisturbed well-being. It's the absence of strife. Jesus came to give us what he walked in perfectly on this earth so he can do the same thing for us. He did not come for us to have a lower life than him. Why? Because he's giving us his peace. It's not a lower peace. It's my peace. Jesus lived in undisturbed and untroubled well-being. You know what that means? He can access anything God had at any time. And that's your peace. When you can access anything God is, any time of the day, you have his peace. Think about that. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world give. Oh. And they'll make you promises and can't keep them. Jesus said, what I'm giving you is a promise I can keep. And then he tells you, look at the verse now. Let not your heart be troubled. About nothing? How can he have a deep concern about that? I mean, I can't just be bothered about the weather a little bit or how hot it is. This is strong. I can't even be bothered about no kinfolks, how the bank did my money, how a job did me, how the stock market did. I can't be troubled by nothing. And neither be afraid of nothing. And the only way you can live like this is you are in a constant relationship with Jesus where you are on the receiving end of his love for you every day. It's on the white side. Go to Ephesians 2, verse 12. Get ready for that. All I can tell you is you're going to be shouting in just a minute. I'm going to get 12 and 13 and then 14. Now listen to this. I want y'all to see this. I pray the Holy Spirit. Just many of y'all know these truths, but I believe the Lord gonna bring it out in a way that'll make it be more light to you.
Yeah. Amen.
And then others, you just gonna be to run with it. Because this should be the thrill of your life. And at that time you were without Christ. Let's think about that. How many of y'all remember that? When you was without Christ. Well, I can go back there. It take a little short journey. Drugs, crack, cocaine, heroin, robbing and stealing. Miserable. 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 Had no hope. No hope. Had no covenant with God, no promises from God, no promises from nobody. Mama couldn't help me, daddy couldn't help me, my grandmama couldn't help me. You just have to suffer out in the world. Just suffer. Take that abuse. And they taking it every day. But at that time, you were without Christ. You know what the Holy Spirit told me? He said, tell my people that you are not in that time no more. You are in a new time zone with Christ. When the Bible say you was without Christ, you was without God giving you something. And you are not in that time zone no more.
Amen.
So you are without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise. Now look how we was. Having no hope and without God in this world. Now what was we without? Did y'all get his love? Now tell me what his love is. Jesus Christ on the cross. We was without his love. We was without his love. Having no hope. We had nothing to be expecting for God to change in our life. And we was in this world without his love, his redemption, his forgiveness, his mercy, his kindness, his grace. We was without. But thank God for verse 13. But now. Everybody say, but now.
But now.
In Christ Jesus. Where?
In Christ
Jesus. Nowhere else. Not in Moses, not in Job, not in Jeremiah. It's amazing.
Yes.
I listen to people, you know, work a message and work no Jesus. But now in Christ Jesus, you who sometimes were far off, I made nigh close by the blood of Christ. This is Jesus' peace. It's the blood of Christ. Verse 14, for he is our peace, same Greek word. Who have made both one, Jew and Gentile, broken down the middle wall of partition between us. That them that had the covenant, we didn't have it. He broke that wall down and gave everybody the covenant.
Yeah.
Listen to this. This is how you came in. Through his blood. He had to give you something. Had to give you something. That demands no works in your strength. Has to give you something. Jesus has to give you something to bring God to you and to bring hope to you. He has to give you his blood. And this blood is supposed to be remembered that he always will love you, that he will always be there for you, that he will always come through for you. If you will let him and be in remembrance of what his blood did for you every day. This is the key, saints, of the foundation of Christian salvation. And most people, saints, do not thank Jesus for his blood every day. They do not remember in the hardest tests and the hardest trials. If you would go to the blood, your faith would rise up like a champion. That's why he loved you while you were young, sir. Was with his blood. Was with his blood. That right there will cause you to lose sight of everything you have ever did wrong. It will cause you to lose sight that God want to bless you. It will make you lose sight and knock out all condemnation that the Lord want to come through with you even when you're wrong. Because of the blood. Because of the blood. This is our peace. It's that he loves us. He died for us and took our sins away. And if people don't stay focused on this, on the blood, they become weary. And let me tell you where they end up at. They end up in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17 and 18. They end up looking at things that are seen instead of things that are not seen. They end up trying to make this thing work in their own strength. Because he's not giving them his peace. He's not giving you his peace. When you don't remember his blood. His blood, let me share this, because Pastor Hill totally agrees with this. Jesus' blood has already taken all your sins away that you've committed and the sins that you're going through, if you're going through any, and the ones you're going to do. He never needs to forgive us again. There never needs to be another sacrifice for our sins no more. Never. It's done forever. Now you have to go receive it. There's some people preaching on TV that we ain't got nothing to do. But I don't agree with that. I believe you have to receive this by faith. Amen. If it just worked for everybody, nobody had to get faith to get saved, because everybody's saved. Because the work has been completed for everybody to be saved. So they say that 1 John chapter 1 is wrote to sinners. No, it ain't. It's wrote to Christians. Let me tell you how I know. Jesus told me. I sinned after 3 months of walking with the Lord. And I'm talking about, I heard Jesus talk to me every day for years. 15. Before he started, he birthed me into another ministry, another level. And he started making me be led by my intimate witness. Is this another level? And I cried and repented about 50 times, because I hadn't got to 1 John 1 9 yet. And for 3 days, every time the devil got a chance, he said, oh, that's it. And I cried and repented again. And the Lord just got tired of it. And one morning, the Lord he did a lot of supernatural things in my life. He would open my Bible up. When I complained, he opened up to Moses and tell me, stop, I never complain no more. Then he opened up 1 John chapter 1, took all the words off the page, except verse 9. And I read, and here's what Jesus said to me. When you asked me one time, I never remembered it no more. And even though we have been forgiven in heaven, we have a responsibility to walk in that forgiveness every day of our life.
Amen.
Even though it's a gift, it still has to be received and lived every day by faith. And don't let nobody tell you 1 John 1 that is wrote to sinners, because they're in error. Now, how do you know, Pastor Scales? Well, John was a Christian, wasn't he? And John said, if we confess our sin, if he was talking to sinners, he was a sinner too. And then John said, then John turned around and said this, which is astounding. John, if he was talking to sinners, then they've got to confess all their sins and get saved. I could have never got saved if I had to remember everything. Oh God, I couldn't get saved if I got to remember. Oh God, how many of y'all, if you had to go back and confess your sins to get saved, how many of y'all lying raising your hand up? Could raise your hand up. You can't confess your sins to get saved. You're already forgiven. You have to receive forgiveness. In Acts 26, verse 18, you receive forgiveness. All in verse, you receive forgiveness. You have to. You have to be born again and get your nature changed. You can't deal with all your sins to come in the kingdom. Jesus dealt with that for you.
Good, amen.
And what ministers do, they get a revelation from Jesus about grace, that God never quits loving us, and some people don't believe that. And God never quits loving us, but we cannot walk in it. And they believe you it don't matter, but it do matter. It really does, because the word tells. And so, Jesus is our peace in his blood. And so your faith in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 17, 18. Y'all got that fucking there? This one messes people up. While we look not at the things, 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians. Samuel. I love you. Praise the Lord. That's your son. That's, okay, in train. Oh, he got it now. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. How can when you go through a test and trial work something exceedingly for you when you're going through hell? What could work that's exceeding? Go back to 17. Before you hit 18. What worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory? What could that be? Him loving us. This is what he is trying to tell you that's going to work for you way more than what the test brought you. Is God coming in that thing and loving you and bringing you up out of that? Y'all see it? He works for us a far more exceeding at every test you have. You should say, God's love is to bring something great in this. You shouldn't be looking down. You shouldn't be feeling bad. You should be rejoicing that you have an opportunity to see God's great love come through for you in that situation. Look at verse 18 now. While we look not at the things which are seen. Why? Because that's not God's love. Whatever's coming against you is not His love. But at the things which are not seen. Do you know something that you can't see? It's the cross, how He loves you. You can't never see it. You have to believe.
Glory to God. Let's do it.
You have to believe it.
Amen.
For the things which are seen are temporal. But the things which are not seen is eternal. In Peter. Are we over there near Peter? Are we not? I need Peter. I need chapter 1, 1 Peter. That's it. Verse 7 and 8. Y'all got your shouting clothes on, but you can't read this and don't shout. I say you can't read this and don't shout. His blood is the key to us staying in remembrance of His love for us. It's the key, saints, of you prospering correctly. That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perish, though it be tried with fire, may be found unto the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. Oh, but verse 8. Oh, this is so exciting. Whom having not seen, you love. Though now you see Him not, yet believing, you gotta believe He loves you. You don't get to see it in no text. You got to believe that thing before you get to see it. That what His blood did for you cannot be reversed because you went through something or you're going through something. His blood cannot be reversed against you. It has to be believed. And what does it believe? What do you? How do you believe in His love? When do you know when you really believe in His love? rejoice.
Glory to God.
It's no way you can go through a trial and believe in his love and be saved.
Right.
His love whooped the devil while you were yet a sinner. His love redeemed you from the curse of the law while you was a sinner.
Yeah.
His love bought you with a price while you was yet a sinner.
Yeah.
His blood. That's our peace. That's our peace with God. That's our peace.
Yeah.
That's how we know we got peace with God. It's through the blood of Jesus. That's how we always know, no matter what's going on in our life, it's his blood that lets us know he still loves us.
Glory to God.
You ought to spend I spend every day for 23 years worshiping him with his blood. I don't know how that many people do that. I never forget his blood.
Yeah.
I never forget how he loved me while I was a sinner. I can't. That's what's going to bring me through tests.
Yeah.
It's his blood.
Yeah.
And when you know you're forgiven, you know you can get anything from God.
Yeah.
Faith works by love. It don't work by what's wrong with us. People are trying to get God to do something from them, from their need, and not his love for you.
Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Break it down.
Glory.
God want to come through for us because he loves us. He want to bless us because he loves us. He don't want to bless us because we tithe. He don't want to bless us because we give offerings. He want to bless us because he loves us. But you didn't give nothing to get that blood on that cross. And so you give tithes and offerings to live his love, to bless others, and you don't give to bless you. Because he done already blessed you. My son don't come up and give me no money to get him some milk. Here's a seed, Daddy. I wanna sow into you so I can be blessed. He goes in the refrigerator and gets whatever he wants. Why? He's already, he's in the family.
That's right.
The blood brought the wall down and brought us in the family and gave us a right to everything that God gave Jesus. And it takes your obedience of faith to live in this, not to get him to do it. Because he done it.
Hallelujah.
Break it down. He done blessed us with all spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus. So you know. So Pastor Stanis, if all this is a gift, then what's our part? Well, let me tell you. Go to 1 John 5:4-5. This is the victory that overcomes the world. Even our faith. This is the victory, y'all. Now, let me break down a little bit what faith is, you understand? Because I bring it from a little bit different angle, but it's not wrong. It don't contradict the word. But I believe it'll give you more light to walk in hearing this. It'll add to what you got. But saints, to me, and the way that I look at faith as Jesus Christ. I never am trusting the Lord without Jesus Christ. But I don't never get in no battles without Jesus. I be watching people trying to believe God without Jesus. That's rough. You trying to confess it in, trying to, use some strength to try to get it in. But Jesus said, whatever you ask the Father, listen, go in my name. Tell God what I did for you on the cross. Always take me in the throne room. Because God is not going to bless you because of you. gonna happen. Because you ain't done nothing to get God to bless you. God is gonna bless you because of Jesus.
Yes.
That He lived perfect.
Yes.
And so your life has to be 1 John 5:5. Who is he that overcomes the world? Who is he that overcomes every test and every trial? Who is he that overcomes every problem? Who is he that has no financial needs? Who? But he that believeth that Jesus is the one sent from God, took our sins away, knows everything, got everything figured out, and our obedience is to trust Christ to show us how to live this and walk in his victory. That's our whole, that should be our whole life, is trusting Christ. Supposed to do. It's just Christ. It's receive Christ, faith, receive, and trust Christ. Do it again. What do you receive? The blood, unconditional love. Okay, next day. Next stage. Receive Christ's love. Bam. Come through that. Receive faith, faith, faith to faith. Faith, faith, and faith. Receive his love. Lord Jesus, I don't know what to do. Well, he do. You know, you ever hear people say, you know, we can't find no job? Have you heard people, you know, you pastor, you know, people say, we can't, I just say, I done put in all these jobs, can't. And you know what I tell people when they come to me to say that? I say, well, Jesus know what jobs are. Oh, I done looked everywhere. What? You need to stop looking. Where we just, you know, we just having trouble in our family. Well, Jesus ain't. He ain't having no trouble. He's in undisturbed, untroubled, well-being, trying to get that to you, show you what to do while you screwed up.
Amen.
Well, we done got behind on our rent. Well, Jesus ain't behind.
Thank God.
He ain't behind in nothing. He knows how to get people ahead, caught up and ahead. Oh, we just can't seem to get this thing together. Jesus can. He's got all things together. It's amazing people just simply don't believe that Jesus know everything and got everything figured out. It just amazes me how people can stay troubled and be afraid when Jesus know everything. Come on, y'all, wake up. I said he know everything. Got everything figured out. And you done been made nigh to him by the blood. And that blood is supposed to keep you nigh to him loving you. That is supposed to kill everything that'll try to tell you God ain't gonna come through when you trust that blood. I always go pray with the blood first. I don't go pray without the blood. I always go to God and say, Father, by the blood of Jesus, I approach your throne. By his authority, I come in your presence. By the obedience that Jesus lived, I come in your presence. You don't even know what you done did wrong. But I know Jesus didn't do nothing. Like this Christianity is not supposed to be hard. The only thing hard for us is to suffer persecution for people we love. And then the Lord give us strength and peace to go through that if you'll get it from him. He said, y'all have a message Bible on there? Go to 1 Peter, since we, chapter 2, verse 21 and 22. But I need the message Bible. Y'all say they don't have it, you find it on your phone. Yo, you got a Bible, my good, we got it. Jesus said, let me read to you in the King James. This is astounding people when people hear this. Verse 21. I didn't need the King James first. 1 Peter 2:21. For hereunto, now listen to what the Lord is telling you here in this verse. For hereunto were you called. You know, most Christians don't even know they've been called. A lot of Christians hate suffering, but you've been called. Because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps. So about suffering, no cursing, suffering being broke, and suffering can't pay any bills, and I ain't talking about none of that. I'm talking about suffering because you stand up for Jesus, because the devil's attacking you because you're seeking to do the will of God. And he's putting roadblocks, and he's causing things to come against you to stop you from fulfilling God's will. People in your family, people on your job is persecuting. Watch. Verse 22. Who did no sin. Oh, there it is again. Did no sin. Oh, Lord, he did no sin. Neither was guile found in his mouth. Oh, my goodness. Y'all got the Message Bible yet? You all have to read it. Let me get away from the microphone. Now listen to this, y'all. This is astounding when you hear this. Go back and read it for yourself.
This is the kind of life you've been invited into.
This is the kind of life you've been invited into. Some people don't even know they've been invited into this kind of life.
The kind of life Christ lives.
Listen, not the kind of life you're trying to do the best you can. You've been invited to live in the life Christ lived. A perfect life. A total obedient to God life. The only way you can live this is Jesus got to show you how. Your whole life every day is trusting him to show you how.